good now. I hope you're doing well, whoever and wherever you are across the world. Thank you very much for joining me and tuning in. It's great to have you. As always, if you happen to be a returning viewer, listener, viewer, subscriber, welcome to another edition of whatever you want to call this, Talking Tuesday. Of course, you can listen to this. You know, I publish these on Tuesdays, but obviously anyone can listen at any time, and we'll be tuning in at any point in time, whether the day this is published to YouTube or a year from now. I'm sure you may be able to notice, especially if you're returning viewer, the fake potted plant I have off to my right. I purchased that about 2 years ago to be put in a video, and I thought I would start putting it in these videos just to add a little something more. Maybe I'll get another one and put it over here to my left, and I'd like to do something a little bit more than have that corkboard behind me. Yeah, whatever. If you notice here to my left, little cheap wired mouse and equally cheap blue mouse pad. And that's what I use to edit my videos. And it's on my left because I've recently switched from using the mouse with my right hand, and I'm left-handed. But that's kind of how we were all taught, mouse on the right. And so, boy, since sometime in the 90s, when I first got a computer and started using a mouse, So for 30 years, I was using and gripping a mouse with my right hand, not just at work, but I would come home at night and play games on the PC. And eventually, starting about 5 years ago, I started to develop some carpal tunnel-like symptoms. And I'm not here to complain or whine about my problems, but I like to share these in case anyone else is experiencing, or to help anyone else avoid this possible scenario. And so, starting at one of my last office jobs, back around 2015, I learned to switch the mouse and start using it with my left hand, and it was a little difficult at first, but let me tell you, the relief that I started to feel from my right arm was like, you know, it wasn't overnight, but I started to see the benefits in a matter of days or so. But when it comes to editing my videos, I still had to use the mouse on my right hand, and that's been fine. I no longer play PC games either. I'm on a console, so that helped for the most part. But I started to feel those symptoms arise again, and I about a year ago or two, I bought a wrist support. It has a metal bar that runs underneath, and it's Velcro. It wraps around your hand and your wrist, and it's supposed to prevent your hand from compressing the medial ligament or whatever it is from doing that gripping, bending action of using a mouse. And that was working for a while, but eventually not. And so I just, about, almost 2 weeks now, I just learned to use my left hand to edit my videos. And I still, that's a video I like to do, editing a video ASMR, just to, maybe you'll find it interesting. Some folks had suggested that as well. So if you are behind a computer a lot, I wouldn't say it's going to be a problem if you have a computer for video games, and it's being in a computer isn't your full-time job. So if you're using a mouse for 3 hours a day, maybe at night, just to play video games, I think you'll be okay. But if you're younger, whether you're in your teens, 20s, 30s, younger than 50, which is what I am. Well, I'll be 52 this year. And you are behind the using a mouse a lot, like 8 hours a day, then you might want to consider training yourself to use your other hand and arm, because eventually you're going to run into the same problem. You can do the stretching exercises where you bend your hand backwards, and that's all fine, and that will provide some temporary relief. But as long as you continue to grip the mouse and everything, with your right hand, it could still lead to a problem. So I would just recommend trying to learn to switch, and maybe you can just, it doesn't have to be permanent. You can, one day right hand, the next day left hand, just to give your arm a break. And if you're someone that isn't behind a computer and a mouse that often, then none of this applies to you. But they do make some mouses or mice that are ergonomically designed, like vertical. I tried one of those, just couldn't get used to it. So instead, I just made the switch and to use my left hand for using a mouse. So that's that. Ergonomics, I guess. That's what they call that, I believe. So I have nothing on the agenda here in this video to talk about. I'm just going to ramble about whatever kind of I have. I wasn't planning on starting the video with that, but I was actually going to start the video with what I'm about to talk about now, and then we'll just kind of do this stream of consciousness thing and see where the next, half hour or 45 minutes takes us. So I got my first tick bite last year when I went out to do some nature photography, wildlife photography. I've had ticks on me before on about two occasions, and I've been throughout the woods all throughout my life. And last year at that time, the 51 years of my life, was the first time I actually found a tick feeding on me. So I went out into the woods. I wasn't in the heavy woods. I was walking in an area where there's some grass. The grass wasn't completely cut low, but it wasn't completely overgrown. And I had my jeans on, over my, jeans, just, how do you normally wear them? And they're over the, around the shoes, top of the shoes. And I didn't think about ticks at all because of where I was walking and everything. And so I went out, this is with the new photography lens that I purchased. So if you happen to see what I do on Instagram or Flickr with the mostly the bird photos, I did a video last year unboxing the new camera gear, I think. And so it was like the first day of using, trying out the new gear. And I left at like 11 or 10 in the morning and got back. In the afternoon, some point, like 2 or 3 o'clock. Usually I spend about 3 hours doing photos, and then my brain is like, okay, that's enough. I get like tired of looking at everything. It's kind of funny. I can only do it for like 3 hours. And then I could probably take a break and do it again, but I feel like I have this energy to just look around and spot birds and movement. And it only lasts like 3 hours, and then I get burnt out, and then I'm done. And so I came home, and I changed. I don't even remember how I found the tick. I changed at some point. And then the tick was on my right leg, on my inner thigh. Halfway between my groin and my knee. And it was still flat, the tick, so it wasn't like very, it must have just started feeding within the past couple of hours, or maybe hour, who knows. And I grabbed tweezers, and I was able to grab it by the head and pull it off. I was freaking out a little bit, not like freaking out and, going psychotic and yelling and screaming, but just kind of, a little scared and nervous that I was going to get Lyme disease. So I contacted the doctor. I'm not sure if this was on a weekend. I think it was a weekend. Called the doctor. I think I left a message or sent them a message, and they basically wrote back that symptoms, or it takes like 24 hours to get Lyme disease or something like that. Basically, there was nothing for me to worry about because I found the tick early enough, removed it, and all that. So, as far as I can tell, I'm fine. I'm pretty sure I don't have Lyme disease or contracted it. And it's not that every tick carries Lyme disease. There's just there's a certain chance of you getting it from a tick. And then it did leave behind a little bit of a welt. There's like a little bit of a lump where I removed the tick. So I'm not sure if, I'm not sure why. I never looked into that. I'm assuming I don't know if part of its head got left behind, stuck underneath my skin, or there's a little lump there as a reaction from my body. I don't know. It's kind of weird. And the other thing is, I never got the bullseye. So that was another positive sign that I didn't contract Lyme. It got a little red, irritation, kind of red, like a little bit of a rash, but not the bullseye. And so hopefully that is my first and last tick bite. Normally when I go out into the woods, and if you're someone that goes into the woods, you gotta make sure you avoid wearing dark clothing, because obviously the ticks are black and they're small. It's not that they're all over. I don't want to make anyone feel paranoid. But if you're out walking on a path and out in the woods, local park or whatever, and the path maybe has some bushes or branches, kind of, the path is kind of narrow and you'll be brushing up against brushes and branches. Just be careful. Or if you're walking somewhere where there's going to be some grass that's going to be fairly high. I don't mean up to your knees, but above ankle level. So just exercise a little caution. What I do when I'm going out to do my nature photography, which I only do once or twice a month, three or four times a year, around May or June, and then maybe September, October. I don't like going out into the heat the middle of summer when it's hot, because that's just no fun, standing around in the heat with long sleeves and long pants on to avoid getting ticks and taking pictures of birds and just standing in the heat for 3 hours. That's not a lot of fun. I might do it once in the heat of the summer. So what I normally wear is I have a light khaki colored long sleeve button-up shirt, and I'll wear that tucked into my light colored khaki pants, and I tuck the pants into my white socks, and then wear boots. And that's to prevent, because where I walk in some places, I usually sometimes walk off the beaten path. So I walk in places where the grass can be a little bit higher than normal. And so if I get a tick, it's not going to be able to get under my clothing. And usually I spot it before it, gets up to my waist. Pretty much every 5 to 10 minutes, I do a tick check. I just look down front and back of my pant legs and see if I see a little black speck moving, climbing up my legs. And so that was the first tick bite. I ever got. I'm not sure about you, if you've ever found ticks or ever got a tick bite. I was out on two other occasions, and I found ticks on me. But fortunately, they were on the outside of my clothing. And that always used to make me think about hunters, people that go hunting in the woods, and how they prepare, because they're out in the woods a long time. Whether they're duck hunting or even just fishing, you can be out navigating through the brush to go fishing. I even found a tick on me just outside of our house when I was doing some weeding and stuff around the bushes. And, I found a tick on me from that. So, bugs are everywhere. In certain locations, you get roaches. In certain areas, you get centipedes, house centipedes, ants. You'll always have ants crawling around your house. I don't mean always, but you'll see the occasional very tiny little brown ant. I'm not talking about the bigger black ants. I mean ants, those really small, tiny brown ants, they love anything like food related. Anything sweet, especially. I mean, but you can't prevent an ant or at most insects from getting into your apartment or your house. Houses, houses and apartments, they're just not made like airtight, like a safe, like a vault. There's always little cracks and separation between the outside ground and foundation, or just, it's between the roof and the wall, whatever. I did buy paramethrin, I think it's called. It's an insecticide. You spray it on your clothes. I did spray it on my khakis, but I did on another occasion find a tick on those khakis. So it didn't seem to work. Unless it faded, I applied it, sprayed it all over my khakis, around on the pant legs, mostly, let it dry outside, sprayed it outside, and it was a couple weeks later, and I still found a tick, so, I don't know how well that stuff works. I also bought another lotion, insect repellent. I forget the name of it. Comes in a big container with a big, well, not with a big, but with a, what do you call that? You press it down, and that's where the lotion comes out, the dispenser. So you apply that on your skin, wherever. And that helps keep mosquitoes and bugs away. And that's supposed to also be a tick repellent as well. And speaking of hunting, I've always kind of wanted to hunt recently, but throughout most of my life, I never really thought about it. But now that I've gotten older, I've kind of reached it. I've always been somewhat more emotional throughout the first 30, 40 years of my life. And emotionally sensitive. And to the point where I don't think I could actually shoot an animal. But over the last 5 years or so, I think I would have no problem hunting and killing a deer. As long as I could get everything I could out of it in terms of meat. I don't like the idea of sport hunting, whether it's duck, fish. I think, you know, I like the idea of hunting and killing an animal to eat, because that's what we need to do. That's what all of life does. You know, humans are no different. Everything has to eat. Everything has to die. That's just, it's a strange, you know, when you think about how beautiful life is, the birds and the, you know, the different, you know, the cats and dogs and reptiles and you name it, and people. But there is a very violent dark side to those beautiful creatures. And that is the fact that all those beautiful creatures need to kill those other beautiful creatures. So it's a constant war to survive. Not just, you know, like how many birds have to kill fish, and the whales eat the plankton, and the spiders eat the flies, and on and on. It's, you know, all throughout the world, 24/7, it's war. It's kind of interesting when you think about life and what life is. It's just this strange state or existence of energy. What are organisms? You know, before life evolved on the planet, now let's hold that thought. I want to get back to hunting real quick. I would love to go hunting, but the reason I don't is for it's too much work. And just let me explain. I would have to get a hunting rifle, learn, you know, get a license, learn how to shoot it, maintain it, probably. And then go find a place to hunt, and then get the clothing, and then learn all the precautionary measures to take while out in the woods, and then have to be away from the family or in my wife and son, not really interested in hunting. So it's, I feel it's one of these things that I, and maybe you might be able to relate to this. You get an idea, you want to do something, you want to try something. Oh, I want to get into photography. Oh, I want to get into whatever. You get into it, you put all the money into it, and then you do it, and then you're like, okay, that was like one and done. I find myself at times doing a thing just to experience it, and then once I'm done with it, I really couldn't be bothered with doing it ever again. And And I feel the same thing would be with hunting. I would buy the rifle, get the license, blah, 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 go out, maybe shoot my first deer, and then realize all that trouble and effort and travel and time and money just for some meat that I can get anywhere else. Now I know there's the whole, now it's all about the experience and the journey. But yeah, I don't know. Something I think about, and that kind of, you know, I really wish I was born and raised in the time of our hunter-gatherer ancestors. As strange or silly or ridiculous as that might sound, you know, why would I say that? Look at all the comforts I have, you know, in this modern society. But modern society just seems to lack. It doesn't seem like we're living, you know? But this modern society, while all the entertainment is fun and all the food, there's still something lacking. It still leaves much to be desired. But anyway, not to say our hunter-gatherer ancestors didn't, you know, had it easy. But, I don't know, there's something very appealing about that lifestyle. Native, you know, the same thing that makes me interested in Native American or indigenous people. Something very beautiful in that simplistic, natural, almost pure way of living. When you're total freedom, you do what you want, there's no money, everybody kind of pitches in, it's real community. Anyway, so, yeah, not sure if you've ever hunted, if you could hunt. I mean, could you kill another animal to eat? Yeah, so, but back to my other line of thought about life on Earth and how it's just a constant state. You might go to sleep at night, and millions of people are asleep in a certain part of the world, and on the opposite side, they're awake. But not just that, but all the animals and insects all across the globe. What I'm trying to say is the Earth is constantly active with life, no matter, even at night, when we're all asleep, you have nocturnal organisms, moths, bats, certain animals that are nocturnal. And not to mention the weather, obviously the ocean, tides, the waves, they're still going, but aside from the weather and all that, you just have animals and insects constantly hunting. I mean, that's like the main reason we're all here. That life is here to consume itself. And so I want to talk about that. So some people believe that a God created life and all that. I don't believe that. So we're going to go with the what might actually be the true fact that all of life on this planet started from nothing but oxygen and hydrogen, and they coalesced. And nitrogen, I guess. And somehow they formed the very first stage of life, the single-celled bacteria, or whatever. And then over how many thousands or millions of years, those simple life forms evolved and turned into probably fish, and then plants, and then some of those fish turned into lizards, and lizards into apes, and then one particular ape species evolved into us. But my point is, prior to life on Earth, it was just the stuff of space. I mean, that's where we come from. The Earth formed due to the effects of gravity and all these big, large bodies of rock colliding. And there is, the Earth has a molten core because I believe, I forget the reason why. But I don't want to get into, all the specifics, but that's how pretty much the Earth was formed. And then you had meteors colliding onto the surface of the Earth. And so the Earth was just a barren rock, so to speak, with a molten core. And then somehow ice, and I think I might have talked briefly about this in a previous episode, so I don't want to repeat myself too much, but basically other stellar or bodies in space, comets or asteroids or what have you, crashed onto the Earth and deposited different elements, oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, and eventually an atmosphere was formed, and condensation and weather and water, and those were the very first basic ingredients that led to the formation of life on the planet. And so here we have this planet with life, and its whole purpose is to eat each other and reproduce. So life on the planet is not much different than life or the universe. The universe is constantly, making new stars. Stars are dying. You have black holes. You have comets, rocks traveling through space. So there's just like this constant state of energy that's constantly trying to, I don't know how I want to put it, energy that's constantly trying to renew itself. It's just kind of interesting. And so that's, the universe is just like an energy creation machine. It's constantly creating or discharging energy. And then that energy created life, those molecules. I mean, that energy, of the comets or the asteroids that crashed on the Earth. So one particular theory goes, deposited ice, you know, frozen water, and, you know, that's kind of basically one of the theories as to how the Earth got water and an atmosphere. So, yeah, so energy impacting the Earth coming together, that's energy. And then that energy, the result of which led to life being created on the planet. And what is life? You know, we often ask, what is the purpose of my life? Well, it's really simple, to eat and to reproduce. However, if you are someone, I mean, you don't have to reproduce, right? So don't worry about that. That's not so important. The eating part, I think that's kind of important. I think we can agree on that. You don't ever have to have kids, and that's fine. But you have to eat. Unless you happen to be some strange entity. Maybe you're a rock, and then you don't have to eat. Yeah, so that's your purpose, is to eat, to consume other life forms, to kill, to bring about the demise of other life forms. And that's fine. It's just how it is. It's funny how we humans, we get so caught up in ethics and morals, whereas every single other life form on this planet would have no qualms with eating you or me should it find us out there in the woods and it's hungry, right? So, I mean, obviously there are herbivores, so a rabbit, you know, we're not going to get attacked by a group of rabbits. But, so that's just life. And I say this to make it a little easier, because that's something I've kind of struggled with. This society makes it really difficult to live up to any kind of ideal. Because you think about, well, I would never hurt an animal. But in order to exist in this society runs on, and I hate to keep saying this, on factory farming. So the mass slaughter, destruction, and consumption of pigs, cows, and chickens, and fish every day. You know, it's fun, and I'm not trying to make anyone feel bad. But these, I'm sure, plenty of people think this way, and I've thought this way myself. I would never harm anyone, right? On the one hand, I would, you know, on my left hand. On the left hand sits my ideals, my morals. I would never hurt another creature. On my right hand are all the animals that we do kill to survive. Now, you could be a vegetarian, okay? But as long as you participate in society, use its internet, use its, buy clothing, use money, you know, exist in modern society, you are taking part and exchanging, making transactions with other people who do eat meat. Even if you're a vegan. And again, I'm not here to make a guilt trip or anything. I'm just saying that the people that make our clothes, the people that work for the internet companies, the people at the banks, the people that deliver your packages, the people behind everything, the construction, the electricians, the plumbers, we're all, you know, connected in this modern society. So that's your main purpose as an organism, to kill other organisms, to eat plant, meat, protein-based, whatever. But as far as your purpose in life, what do you want to do in life that makes you happy? Well, that's the more existential question, isn't it? That's aside from the food thing, that's one of the more challenging, ever important, age-old question. What do I want to do with my life, especially that makes me happy? And it's not easy. But, you know, the only thing I can tell you is keep searching, keep trying to find, you know, a job or a hobby that, you know, that you can find that's fulfilling, that makes you happy. And, of course, that helps pay the bills and makes money, unfortunately. You know, my ideal society would be where there is no money. Kind of like a hybrid primitive slash modern. So there's no wage. There's no money. You can do whatever you want. And as long as you are contributing and doing something, you know, you can have whatever you want. You know, so as long as you're not just sitting around doing nothing. So as long as you're contributing something, that's all. I don't really think anything has to have a price tag on it. I've said this before. I can get seeds and grow them. I can get a pig and mate pigs and have a pig farm. And I can just give that away. I don't have to put a price tag on that. I'm not trying to get too political or whatever. But we created price tags. We created economy and politics. So those things can be changed or removed. Capitalism, communism, socialism, we created those. Those are not laws of nature. Those are not laws to live on Earth. They're just man-made things. So, really, I mean, nothing needs a price tag. All that's important is eating. Let's say you paint for a living. And let's say this ideal society of mine, where there's no money. So you paint, you need to eat. So you need to give your painting to someone, so that you can get some food, right? So, like a system of trade and barter, I suppose. Now, how do you get that food? Do you just wait for someone that has food to come along to trade you? Right, so then you say, okay, well, what if I get a voucher? So I sell my painting to someone, they give me like a food voucher. Right? So now you're back to having a system of currency, you see. So it's kind of difficult to you know, as ideal or utopian a society sounds without money. How do you go about, you know, do you just make it so there are people that grow the food and the meat, or farm the animals, and then just give it away. So if I'm a painter, you know, it gets a little complicated. And then there's a problem of, you know, farming animals, which I don't really like the idea of. But what are we going to do? How are you going to, you know, I'm not a PETA person. I'm not an activist at all. These are just, I make observations. I kind of would like to see fairness to all of life on the planet. Yeah. But what was I just saying about farming animals? You know, how are you going to feed the millions of people in the dense cities? Let's say, if we all agreed that the factory farming of animals, pigs, cows, and chickens isn't good. So you set free all those animals. Well, now you have the millions of people in the cities and the surrounding areas. They don't know how to hunt. So, I mean, you're basically just starving them. So it's a catch-22. Damned if you do, damned if you don't. So I don't know what the solution is. Maybe we're too far gone now. Maybe we're too far gone now as a society to go back. But that's been on my mind, and I hate to keep bringing it up. But, you know, on one hand, we try to be good people and help other humans and help other animals. But on the other hand, we're engaged in a system that slaughters pigs, cows, and chickens by the billions annually all throughout the world. And that's okay. For some reason, I know it's kind of weird, strange to talk about. Yeah. You know, for some reason, it's totally acceptable and the norm to just treat and eat pigs, cows, and chickens and fish. Treat them just like a throwaway organism. It's just a chicken. It's just a cow. It's just a pig. But yet, dogs and cats and other humans are somehow deserving of a better life. And that's all I'm getting at. It's an observation. I mean, don't pigs, cows, and chickens deserve a life where they just roam free? And they're not bred just for our consumption, for human society? That's, you know, that's what I've been toiling over. The conundrum, the hypocrisy, the cognitive dissonance between what we do and say and think versus the reality that we often are blinded. We keep blinders on to avoid the real truth. And you start talking like this to some people and they think you're crazy, but it's the truth. Right? How can you say you're a good, kind person when you participate in a society that has a lot of dark truths to it? So, at least when you're a primitive, you know, hunter-gatherer, you're only killing what you need. Now, did some primitives or some indigenous people farm? I think the Native Americans farmed corn. I'm not going to sit here and say you shouldn't farm corn. The corn deserved to be free. I mean, it's just corn. There's a difference between corn and a pig and a cow and a chicken. So there's a lot of, what you want to call it, disconnect between, you know, there's just a lot of, yeah, just what I said. I don't want to say necessarily hypocrisy. I'm not going to say you listening or watching are a hypocrite because you like your pet and you care for people more than you care about pigs, cows, and chickens. But I'm just pointing it out. That's all. But, you know, nobody cares. And I don't mean to say that nobody cares, like whining. I mean, I don't care. I mean, I still eat cow. I still go to the market and get meat. But I'm aware of the inherent hypocrisy, cognitive dissonance that comes with participating and living in this society. And I just wonder, you know, am I the only one that thinks this way? So, anyway. So that's all that I really had to talk about. I didn't mean to talk about what I just did last few minutes towards the end here. But, you know, it is what it is, as they say. So I'm going to end it here. Thanks for tuning in, as always. And hope to speak to you, see you next week and or any other video that I put out. And until then, take care. Wish you all my best. Stay well. Stay safe. Enjoy being an organism, consuming other organisms. And I'll see you soon. Take care and so long for now.